Can anybody see my screen?
Not yet.
Oh, always gotta have some. Oh, there we go. Okay, we're good?
Yep.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Recreation Stadium and Fieldhouse Conversation. I'm Chris Andrew with B&A Planning Group. And from our core team, we have Jeff Dyer with B&A Planning Group. We have our subject matter expert, Robert Lockhart with the Rethink Group. Also from B&A, we have Bridget Hodge, who is our engagement specialist. And from our panelists, we have Boris Dragosevic. I'll get it by the end of the day. University of Calgary. We have Keith Parker, I believe, from the City of Calgary Parks. James McLaughlin from the City of Calgary Parks. We have Florent Lebert from the City of Calgary, I think also with Parks. Sylvia Vajdova with the City of Calgary. David Torres with the City of Calgary. Gregory Steinraths with the City of Calgary. And then from Reds with the City of Calgary, I believe we have Carol Ann Beswick, and we have Garrett Wolberg on the line. And I think Marcia Andrichuk. I believe that's everybody. So I should actually address here, we are recording this session and it is offered to the public. So they are attending a bunch of these sessions. They have the option to, just to be transparent in anything that we're discussing. And again, they're recorded and should be on the website within 24 hours. So some of the key topics that we're going to discuss today, we've already discussed in the morning, we've discussed servicing, utility capacity, and then we got into a transportation discussion. And now we're going to be talking about recreation, the field house, and the stadium. So we're going to just run through an overview from the existing buildings and some of the amenities, some of the planned building and amenities and the projects. And then we'll leverage Robert to get into some recreation trends. You know, we'll consider the perspectives of the city as a whole, and hopefully you can provide some details on what's going on in the city. And then understanding both the existing site and then the university's programming requirements, we can get into a discussion on, you know, what do we want to see on this site in terms of sports and recreation. Then we can identify, you know, some sustainable recreation options. One of the things that have been coming up here is all season design. How can we use the site rather than just focus on like single use amenities in a certain season? How can we offer a wide variety of uses to the public? And then we can address some issues and opportunities with the site. So I don't know, anybody else want to add anything or propose to discuss anything else? Good to go. Yeah, Jeff, I just kind of wanted to go back for this topic specifically, was to try to go, you know, what are some of our guiding principles that are coming out through some of these sessions? Just to reiterate, you know, what are we hearing about the site and how is it going to be used? So the first thing we're hearing is no wasted space. Right now it exists as a very gray field characteristic site with lots of surface parking lots. How can we incorporate multiple uses into the space? It's very suburban car focused right now as an urban, and we want to see that shift to an urban center, leveraging that major activity center designation that the city applies to the site. We want to consider active modes, you know, walkable, bikeable, transitable. How can we create a porous site, allowing people to come to the site, travel within it and through it? Focusing on bike infrastructure along 24th and key transit connections. And then with the whole sports piece to this, the field house being kind of the catalyst of this, is how can we make this an active, dynamic center for sports, recreation, and entertainment? There's even policy references to this throughout it being, you know, a sports village. And then, you know, creating a vision throughout this process and how can we create flexibility in how this is applied through phasing. So again, I think we mentioned the Fieldhouse is the catalyst for this project. It is what is kicking everything off. I think that is the most certain piece we're at right now in terms of what is happening on the site. Jeff, I don't know if you wanted to expand on this Fieldhouse piece or what we.
Yeah, I think it's important, and I want to encourage our last many presentations have been fairly formal. This is really a discussion. If we were doing a live charrette, you guys would be showing up to our design studio on site and gathering up some chairs, and we'd be having a discussion. So, let's keep it informal. You know, feel free to chime in. When you can, and we'll try to make sure to direct traffic if we need to. It is notable that there has been a tremendous amount of work done on this field house in terms of its programming, its siting, its and many other elements related to it. It was expressly discussed with us that we are not here to really be impacting the programming of that particular use. It's really got it has its own process. What we are here for, though, is understanding its context and the impacts on the surrounding area as it relates to a broader plan. And so, and the same has to do with the stadium. You know, we can make some suggestions on interface with the stadium, but obviously they've been in their own process and have gone a long way. So it's not to say that we can't discuss these things or that it's off limits. It's just to understand that if you say, well, we shouldn't have aquatics here, we're not going there, but we can say if we're going to have aquatics, how can it interface differently? How can that building actually respond differently to the context? And that's really what we're talking about here. Robert is here because part of the structure that we have set up for our design team is to bring in sort of a third set of eyes. We have our core design group, our core consulting group, who's responsible for the various studies and really doing a lot of the deep dive on the design. But we have our subject matter specialists who bring in a different perspective, and it kind of helps us to break out of the some of the molds and some of the assumptions. Robert was brought on because we felt there were really three areas of specific issues that we thought would benefit from a subject matter specialist. One was transportation. So we have Mac Logan, who's working with our team. We have on the architecture side, we've got some experience on stadium redevelopments and mixed-use centers. So we have S9 architecture, and then Robert comes on as somebody who's here to give us another set of eyes on this and help us understand, because recreation, ultimately this site has a major recreational function both regionally and locally. So we want to do it some justice and really understanding what the impacts of our efforts are going to be. And so Robert, I'm happy to have you here, and this is a safe space to discuss things, and let's have a good conversation about it. I'd imagine at this point that everybody's fairly familiar with the field house. Part of the issue here part of the opportunity is that although it's replacing the baseball facility, the baseball facilities are very single use. You can do baseball and softball, but mainly baseball, and they're not necessarily accessible to many other activities. The field house is significant in the amount of sports, both regionally and actually nationally, that it could attract. It is an economic development engine, and when you match that to the stadium, we have two components here that are pretty pretty important and have a lot more opportunity than having wide open parking lots and poorly used fields. So that's kind of the backdrop to this. I know we have a lot of city folks on the line here. I also have to make some assumptions that most of you had a chance to look and see our our presentation, particularly yesterday, we put some concepts on the table. And so hopefully you had a chance to see some of those, but we do certainly have some questions, and you know, we'll try to direct traffic again. We want to make sure we cover everything in the next, you know, 48 minutes or so, but there's a lot of room to go here, so.
I was going to say,
should I share the concept at this point?
I was going to say, maybe at this point we can just, I was going to say, if Robert can discuss.
Yeah, sure. Let's talk about this.
Maybe how you got some of the recreation and trends based on the demographic profile. I know you've provided us with this initial report. So maybe how you've observed Calgary from a demographics point of view, and maybe what you're seeing at that level, and then some trends in how sports are, what's trending upwards and downwards, I guess, at a national perspective.
Sure. Okay. Thanks very much. Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay, good. Well, I'm going to jump right into the trends, and I'll relate that back to the population profile as I go, just to make the presentation shorter. So one of the things that I noted was that over the past 25 years, Calgary has grown on average faster than the national average. And what that means is that demand for everything is going to be increasing more quickly than it would be in most communities in Canada, regardless of whether there's an upward trend or a downward trend in a particular activity. So that's just something to keep in mind, that it hasn't been the case every year that the city's been above average, but when you look at it over 25 years, it's considerably above the national average for annual population growth. So the other thing that's really characteristic is that the city's got a younger than average population. There are, you know, particularly in the child and youth and their parents' age group, the 25 to 44 year olds. So I would call that a family-oriented population, a very family-forming population. And what that means is that the kinds of activities of interest to families, both the children and youth as well as the young adults, are going to be above average. And that's going to, again, buck some of the national trends. So some of the national trends are showing that there's a declining demand for things like ice-related activities, some team sports, because some communities are aging more faster than others. So the things that you used to be able to do as a younger person, you can't do as an older person. So there's a general sliding away of demand from some of the high use or the more rigorous activities, and a movement toward things that are more passive, more trail oriented, more maybe less rigorous in terms of of their format. You've gone from tennis to pickleball. That may not be happening as much in Calgary as it is in a place like Toronto or Peterborough, or where the population is a little older. So when you look at a younger than average population, there's going to be increasing demand for things like playgrounds and sports and active recreation, fitness and wellness, arts and culture, because the population is it's above average income and above average educational attainment, which gives you a bit more of a flavor toward the arts and cultural side. A great appreciation for the natural environment, trail-based activities, those kinds of things you're going to see an above average demand for. And also, when you look at the trends overall nationally, so the activities that are going up in demand and some and the ones that are going down in demand, it's going to be muted a little bit in Calgary because of your younger population. You don't have as many older adults as you would in most communities. And so that was putting a lot of pressure on trends as the big baby boom ages into their older adult years. They change what they're interested in. Well, in Calgary's case, because of your younger population, some of those trends aren't developing as quickly, but they will eventually. And so you have to keep that in mind. You will age because everyone who lives there is going to get a year older each year. And the baby boom is already in their senior years. And so they're going to continue to age into the things that they want to do, and that population will get larger. So that's something to keep in mind. I mentioned about household income being above average, educational attainment being above average. Also, you have a very large population of let's just say, visible minority, very large, way above the national average. And so some of the ethnocultural interests of groups and pockets of cultural activity in your community are going to express themselves through demand. And so that's going to be an important thing to keep in mind as well. One of the other things is that the new generation of older adult, the baby boomer senior, isn't going to want to do the things generally that the traditional senior has done. So the senior that grew up in the post-war years is now in their 75 to 85, 90, even older years of age. The things that they were interested in, the younger seniors are not so much. They're bringing a lot of the baby boom interests that they had when they were younger and trying to stay active as long as they can and participate in activities that are wellness oriented and really trying to push off that old age stigma. And so that's going to change the way we need to deliver services for older adults as they become a larger population. The other thing is that some of the other trends that are important to think about is that over the last 20 years, there's been a growing interest in clustering facilities together, whether they be indoor through recreation complexes like this one, or whether it be outdoor. So, you know, instead of having 10 soccer fields independently located throughout a community, it's better to cluster some of them together in groups of three and four to increase the potential for tournaments and also to make it easier to program. Now, you don't want to take it all out of your neighborhood, but you want to, where you have the opportunity, it's good to cluster. So again, that's the opportunity you have here in this project to have a large number of rectangular fields in one location, indoor and outdoor. That's a great combination and fits right in with one of the trends. So that's a good thing to keep in mind. The other trend that we're seeing is a facility one around. When you're looking at artificial turf, when you're looking at that rectangular fields in particular, the movement toward artificial turf to extend the season in facilities is very important. I know your indoor facility will be artificial, but you have a major outdoor and two or three others, depending on the configuration you end up with. So the more of those that are artificial, the more use you can make of them. We consider an artificial turf field to be equivalent to two fields because you can extend the time you're using it. It doesn't wear out as fast. And I was concerned about, I don't understand, I don't have all the details on why the three sort of not so good fields, they appear to be not quite as good as some of the others on site, are not used as much as, let's say, the major field is. So I don't know whether it's a drainage problem or just what the issue is, but if they were artificial, you wouldn't have that problem. Those are just some of the things that I'm seeing. There's a lot more in trends, but those are the biggies. And they just to keep in mind that the trends that are going up and down nationally, we're not going to see them as strong in Calgary because of the younger population. And demand for sports is going to be high, but there's also going to be a demand for arts and culture and nature appreciation and trail use and all the other kinds of things that are of interest to a mid-age and older adult population. So that's going to happen over the next 10 to 20 years, but it's going to be slower to roll out in Calgary. That's the kind of the essence of it. And that's probably enough said for now.
Thanks, Robert.
Does anybody from the city want to comment on that in terms of what you're seeing from a recreation standpoint, or maybe just comment on those trends or if there's anything that stands out?
This is Karina Plaisier. I'm from the site. I oversee the Foothills Athletic Park, and I just wanted to comment about the drainage. Has really been a struggle. It's a low-lying spot around the area, and so that's why we don't make use of those fields that much. I don't know if anybody has any questions about that specifically.
I do actually have some questions. We've had some discussions earlier today. And one of the things that was discussed is the issue of stormwater. And ironically, our consultants were asking if we could use the existing fields for stormwater retention. And I did comment that the fact that they are kind of being used for that now in a and probably a not so efficient way. But the question, I guess, that comes up is, you know, I would say on the outset to Robert's point, and you know, and as a result of his research and some of our other discussions with Sport Canada and others, the point that you know, eliminating any existing fields doesn't really make sense given our situation. So some of those earlier concepts on foothills that showed redevelopment and just maintaining the central field and the new field house, we're putting on the table a net zero soccer field, or let's call it rectangular field, result out of what we do. So we may be eliminating one of those fields, but we're gaining a 100% usable field in the inside of the field house. And to Robert's point, if we did a artificial surface to one or the other fields, we could increase their availability too, including the infield of the outdoor track. The question I have for you is, I think that regardless of where we end up with the field location, I actually like them in the corner, but we're getting a lot of feedback that they like those two fields that we're showing in our concepts, kind of where they are, but reoriented. The question I have for you is, can they be rebuilt in a way that allows for purposeful stormwater retention, but is done in a way that they could actually be utilized more often? So what are your thoughts on that opportunity?
Well, right now we have very high demand, and I'm speaking mostly pre-COVID. We have to close them off because there's times that they're just too wet to use. And sometimes, even though we plan for those times that we think they'll be wet, depending on our rainfall and stuff, we're shutting them down for additional weeks. So the demand is certainly there that I see. There is a lot of peripheral space that we could probably make use to make things happen, but I'm not in the business of designing it to know for sure what they'd come up with. We have an incredibly old irrigation system there. So to kind of rip it up and start over, knowing that they'd be used for many years, I think would be a great plan, and we could probably get some great use. If you're talking artificial turf though, I mean, that would be even better, because I'm sure we could use them like May to October.
James
Lachlan, James, sorry. And then Robert, you can be after James.
Yeah, sorry, I had my mic off before. So I think just further to Robert's comments on usage, we had an agronomist do a study of our natural turf fields, and basically they're good for two soccer games a day, 6 days a week, with a fallow period of 1 to 3 weeks every season. And that's the only way we can maintain turf in our climate, with a real rigorous agronomic plan about maintaining the turf. The fields at this site, as Karina mentioned, are unofficial stormwater retention. I love that, because that's actually how they perform. The whole idea with redevelopment was to maintain the capacity of ours. So losing a number of field, or a field number, losing a field, let's say, but maintaining the overall capacity by hours was the goal. We don't want to have a lower capacity by hours. Also, if we are going to have a recommendation to keep two soccer fields, we'd love to see the ability to convert the two into a cricket pitch with the wickets in between the two rectangular fields if possible. We have a massive demand for cricket. I'll say massive, depending who you talk to. If I talk to the politicians, it's absolutely massive. Substantiating, it's always a challenge, but we know that we're underserved. So getting a cricket pitch of some kind, although most of the demand is elsewhere in the city, this is our pinnacle, or one of our pinnacle athletic parks. So it would be appropriate to be able to accommodate championship games and the like here.
Robert, I'm gonna let you talk. I apologize, please.
Okay, so a couple things. I hadn't thought, well, I had thought about cricket, but I hadn't seen it in any of the thinking yet. One of the things to think about here is that if you're going to try to combine cricket with soccer, you're going to have a compromise on both. I mean, you can do it, and I've seen it done, even in my city of Peterborough, it's done. But the end result is that it's kind of a B level example of how to do it, because you end up with, you know, spreading the fields a little bit further apart and allowing the circle, that's the cricket pitch, to overlap both of the soccer fields. So there's a bit of wear and tear issue that becomes different, and then you've got some competition for time as well, because depending on the demand for each, you can only play. So if you play cricket, you're going to lose two of your pitches, two of your soccer pitches. So my recommendation would be you go one or the other. And if you're going to put a cricket pitch in, it's likely going in this setting, you're going to want it to be a very good one that you can actually have competitions on, spectators at. You want to have it a high profile facility. So therefore, if there's enough demand for it, it should probably be on its own.
If I can just chime in before you run on to the next one, we've been trying to get it on its own for quite some time. And so there's a particular political push to accommodate it where we can. So if we're not going to do it, we're going to need some very carefully worded statements about why. Mm-hmm. Because it'll keep coming back over and over and over again.
Yeah.
Does artificial turf help that situation, Robert?
Certainly it would. If, for example, your major outdoor field, the one inside the track, it's an obvious candidate for artificial turf. Depending on your season, you can not only extend the season, make it longer because, you know, it doesn't freeze the same way as turf does, as regular grass does. You can use it a lot more because it doesn't wear out as fast. And you can, when it's lit, of course, lighting a field also gives you extra use. So if you have an artificial turf field, you want to light it because you want to get as many hours per day out of it as possible. You could even get three games out of it, depending on when you began in the early evening, certainly two. So if you ended up with two outdoor rectangular fields, one cricket pitch, and then your indoor field, and I saw in some of the renderings, there could be more than one indoor field in the field house. Is that right or not?
Okay,
the other thing I'll mention is that a north-south orientation, unless there's something different with the climate and the way the sun sets in Calgary, is the ideal arrangement rather than east-west. That's the way it is in most places. I don't know whether there's something different in Calgary, but what you don't want to do is most soccer and rugby and football, anything that uses a rectangular field, most of it, unless it's on the weekend, is in the evening. And in the summertime, you can get extended use as well when you have more children available and youth for tournaments. The setting sun is your problem. It's the same with baseball. You want to have a 10 degrees north-northeast kind of orientation through the pitcher's mound to home plate. So soccer is very similar. So the idea of turning them east-west is not necessarily great. I'd recommend north-south. So that's kind of it around the outdoor facilities, unless you want to ask me some more questions, because I hadn't thought about the cricket pitch, but certainly if there's enough demand for it, it would be an ideal location.
Yeah, so I don't want to necessarily insert the cricket pitch into the program. I was just thinking in terms of if you were doing two fields, we're getting so much pressure. We either need to show that we can do it or explain very clearly why not.
Well, you could certainly compromise and have, but you wouldn't want to be artificial turf, I don't think, if you're going to be cricket and two soccer fields. So you're really going to limit the use of both of them by combining them together. As I said, it's not a first-class approach to doing it. And this is going to be a first-class recreation facility that will be considered to be regional or even beyond in terms of its scope. You could have provincial and national and international competitions here if you have the right facilities.
We already do. And actually, I was going to ask you about the artificial turf inside the track, how that might limit, because as it exists right now, believe it or not, despite what the track looks like, it is a certified IAAF venue. So any records that are set actually are world records or national records. I wish they were world records, but records that are set at that track are actually registerable as national records.
Okay.
Because it's a certified track. That includes the throwing. So I just want to make sure we wouldn't lose the ability to have throwing in the final plan if we put artificial turf in the center.
Right. Well, those are details that could be worked out much later in the process, as long as you're showing, you know, what you want to have there. And then thinking about what the impact of each decision is. So the example being, if you're trying to combine cricket and two rectangular fields, you can do it, but you're limiting both of them because you're sharing now, and they won't be as high a quality. So that's where that goes. I don't know whether this is a good time to mention a couple of other things about the property, some of which are related to trends and others are just related to the kind of place it is and what you might be able to include there. So I couldn't help but smile and pleasantly when I saw the idea of having some kind of plaza in front of the main front door of the stadium. As a people place, that is a great concept. It fits right in with the mixing of active and passive activities. You know, wide variety of things could happen seasonally there. That's a very good one. I also thought about outdoor skating, whether it be a rectangular or a round or a trail. Trails are exceedingly popular, way more popular than any kind of a rectangular outdoor rink. And so that maybe could be wound into it somewhere. I don't know for sure. And the last thing I'll mention is that as we look to the future, and the rollout of this is going to be, you know, 10 to 20 years probably, maybe even 30, the demand for electric vehicles is continuing to climb. And within 10 to 20 years, over half of all the vehicles on the road will be electric. And so you need to make sure you've electrified everything that happens in here, whether it be the parking lots, the streets, or whether it be all of the residential that goes in, particularly the multi-unit facilities. You want to rough in electrical parking, electrical EV parking in every parking stall in the garage. You can't retrofit it afterwards easily. You want to do it while you're building. When you're building a home, you want to make sure you have 200 amp service at least, so that you can have a plug in your garage or driveway. If you're a street orphan or a garage orphan, and you don't have a place to park your car and you're on the street, you want to have pole-based electric vehicle charging on the lamppost sort of thing, so that you can charge your vehicle at night. So these are just things to keep in mind. It's an infrastructure thing that is not quite recreational, but it's important to consider as we're looking at trends going forward.
Okay. Robert, on that, one of the things we talked about is on concept B that you're seeing here, on the north side of the stadium, we see that road that curves around the stadium, and that seems to be right now the kind of the preferred plan. One of the things that came out of our architect was this idea of a wider kind of Wooner Street that can be programmed. And taking it to the next level, we do know that there is, although we don't want the, tailgating extravaganza, that's kind of probably going to go away, at least adjacent to the site, but we still want to have a tailgating component. So one of the things that's been floated is taking that street and creating treating it like a street, day to day, having head in parking, having sidewalks and trees, but then bringing in electrifying that even for the tailgating component, which really works right into your idea of that being an electric vehicle, having that function day to day. And you know, as you are well aware of, a facility like this that gets used really intensely on very short amounts of time, we're looking to expand it. We want to give people as many excuses as possible to be on this site when it's not, it's not game day or event day. And so being able to fill those spots up and electrify them, and then being able to cross, to bring those into the tailgating component, I think is a huge opportunity. So we're already thinking that way, but it's good to emphasize that we need to.
Okay, just last point to that. Since most charging, 80 to 90% is always done at home rather than in some outdoor, some remote setting, some public place, dealing with the residential is going to be really critical. The other thing is you have to ask yourself, where do people come and hang out for an hour or two? or three. So restaurants and bars, outdoor events like a concert or some sort of a gathering, going to a football game, those kinds of things are when people may want to charge their vehicle when they're going to be there for a while. They also have to be able to get back to their vehicle easily to get it out of the parking space once it's charged, because as soon as it's charged, you get charged more per minute for being there because you're taking up a spot. So it's different than pulling in to get gas and someone's behind you and, you know, they know you're going to be gone in 5 minutes. There's a real penalty in place. So you have to be able to, based on the app on your phone, get back to your parking space to get your car unplugged when it reaches whatever limit you want it to reach, or you'll get screamed at and charged for being there too long. So all of these things are important to think about. And I know there are details for later, but it's probably a philosophy that you might want to build into this for the development itself and all the things that aren't recreational, that you keep that in mind.
I might. Jeff, if I might, I'm very happy to hear you're talking about tailgating. Culturally, I think that needs to be addressed quite strongly. Otherwise, there'll be some resistance to anything that's proposed. There's a fairly big tailgate culture around the team in this town. And so the viability of the team long-term, of course, is of concern, particularly now because of COVID. They haven't played, and we don't know what's happening this year. Also, I'd suggest, if you haven't done it already, and I don't know if it's on the plan, so I'll just say it, dialing in Mike Franco from the Stampeders Group, from the Flames Entertainment Group, about hosting Grey Cup and what would be required to do that.
Good point.
I look at this and I'm going, I could see how it would work, but I'm not the expert. So it'd be good to check with the experts to make sure that you can still host the Grey Cups here, because I know it's part of the long-term vision for the CFL in town, or at least with the organizers. And I had the privilege of sitting on the Grey Cup steering committee, the executive steering committee for the last one we had. There's some folks that know the hosting capabilities down, and it would be great to dial them in just to make sure that door doesn't get closed.
What did you say the name was?
Mike Franco. Yeah. He was the chair.
Limited. You know, there will be tailgating, but we would limit it to some degree, and definitely not let Rough Rider fans have any tailgating whatsoever. But
we'll host them in the field house and take all their money before the game.
Horace, did you have something you wanted to? You're good. Okay.
No, good. Thank you.
Okay, so it sounds like, you know, this is one of those elements that we're not necessarily going to solve through the plan, but maybe we need to make those two fields that are together. And again, we're tending to plan A for where the field location. Plan A is kind of where the Foothill side is going, and plan B is kind of where the McMahon side is going. And so maybe we need to size it for, because this is the time to do that, size it so that it could be a cricket pitch. And then we let that evolve over time.
I don't know. I just reacted to the idea of two fields adjacent to each other.
But that gives
us pressure we're getting from councillors. It wasn't really part of this original concept.
Part of this is somewhat political in that we're almost pretending and we're making decisions now. And so there are decisions that we're helping to make, and you know, we're going to be illustrating a lot of concepts, and we're working out feasibility and inspiring and all that kind of stuff. I think that an easy answer, recognizing that we can't make those decisions right now, is to say we are sizing it so that it could accommodate it, a cricket pitch, or two soccer fields, or two soccer fields, and so we're not. We're going to put it into future generations' hands, or at least the next phase, to really decide. But meanwhile, the whole point of this is not to do anything, not to make any decision that prevents us from doing something else that we may want to do in the future.
Fair enough. Totally get it. That makes total sense. I'd still then look back to Robert to maybe give a couple of paragraphs for the final report, because if we can steer a Class A field elsewhere, and this becomes a different classification, more putting it in context as what's achievable.
Hey Boris, how about putting it in the university, the west fields of the university?
Well, ironically, we're looking at our fields and we're looking to convert some to Robert's point of going from natural, because we've got the same issues that James alluded to. If you want to keep a field pristine for dino soccer, you're very limited in what you can use it for if it's natural. But so we're actually looking at trying to get more longevity, more season out of our fields. And that is an artificial look we're going to. The only comment I had with the fields was it's more driven by where it puts the buildings. And I think that'll come out as we get into the marketing thing is, if we go to the center fields, those buildings to the north, I'd say we're going to need to look at some stepping down to our campus, because when you get north across the road there, we don't have any major development plan. That's our main gate right now, our civic address. So we'd be, you know, trying to look for something in that whole corner, a little more hospitable and contextual all the way around. But we can get into that when we do the market work on the buildings that are proposed there.
Okay, that's a good point. And right now we're stepping down to the neighborhood on that concept. So we could look at, you know, a five story profile around the edge that matches up with the university scale, and then we could wrap some of the other density around the other side. I don't see buildings going over 12 stories here, because we also don't want to have too much shadow impact. So yeah. I think there's going to be some natural limitations that happen with those buildings.
I'll just add one final point. From a tournament point of view, if you're thinking about clustering fields, it really doesn't matter whether they're side by side or slightly, you know, off to the edge, like in Plan B. It's close enough that you could easily walk across a road. It's not going to be a busy space to be able to conduct your tournament and have some good synergy. It's ideal if they're side by side, but either plan would work well.
Okay, good to know.
What about consideration for other things like a festival and event kind of scenario? Because we're also considering, you know, once we go to artificial turf, it's a little more robust. I mean, you don't want kids spilling pop on it, but you can clean stuff like that. And so considering option A or B, I guess the question is, from a hosting perspective, that overlay, that filter might be worthwhile to apply.
Totally agreed. Robert, you have some comments on that.
Yeah, I would, if you're looking at a festival, I would be looking at your plaza as being the place to host that. A hard surface as opposed to a soft surface. If it's large enough, depending on the festival you're talking about, you know, a music festival or where you don't, where you're not, depending whether you need an audience or not. If you're looking at an audience and a stage and all that kind of thing, would you not hold it inside your main stadium?
Depends. It depends on what purpose it is. There's lots of cultural festivals that occur. We have festivals every weekend of the year, and some of them actually prefer the soft turf.
Okay.
Plaza, and it's just the open space, the size of the open space.
Right. So
in terms of having regional capabilities across the city.
Yeah.
So it's a consideration of whether it's possible or not here and if it makes sense.
If you were thinking about that, then the configuration where the fields are in the middle of the site might be a little more comfortable for that, as opposed to, because you wouldn't want to do it on your main field. You probably want to do it on your secondary fields. And if they were up in the corner, you might feel a little bit disconnected, unless you saw that as a festival center and you actually developed it that way so that you had that in mind at the beginning. So it's got a nice street facing element to it, nice and easy to see and get at. That might work too. So keep that in mind. Those are possibilities.
Yeah, and it would serve better as a staging area for the main stadium as well.
Yeah, but parking is also then an issue, because people are going to need to park somewhere. And if the parking is a long distance away from where your festival event is going to be, that could be a bit detrimental. Even though we're trying to promote exercise, people don't always see it as a bonus when they have to walk a long distance in the heat to participate and take their chairs with them and all the gear that goes with the festival. We want to have parking relatively close by.
Well, even from a transit perspective too, I think having it a little bit more central to the plan area. It just is a little bit more natural from walking to that transit connection too, I think.
Yeah, agreed. So I guess the conclusion is that if you want to consider your two secondary fields as also a concert venue or a festival venue, then bringing them into the middle has an advantage. I think that's a good conclusion there.
And I know, Jeff, we talked about too, like the doors on the side of the field house opening up into an open space area that spills potentially out into this area too, right?
Yeah, I you know, so the thing about Calgary and many winter cities is that when it's beautiful outside, where are people? We're a patio culture, and it's like, that's why, you know, you can't be on the patio all year round, but man, if it gets above 5 degrees, you're on the patio. So and so I have this fantasy that side of the field house is a series of big garage doors, you know, with windows that during when the weather is nice enough, they could open up and it becomes an indoor outdoor space. But I recognize also this is a gigantic facility that probably has a HVAC system rivals the West Edmonton Mall. So so I don't know if it's actually possible. And I don't know if this is the crew to answer that question, but that is the dream, is that, you know, you could open this sucker up, and even if you had the seating, because basically that front part is where the temporary those gymnasia are, where the temporary stadium seating goes for a major event. If you flip it around, you got an outdoor track event. If you do a little bit on both sides, you've got an indoor and an outdoor track. You have two tracks going for a major event. And then the big picture is that if that stadium seating could actually roll out and be in front of the soccer field or a cricket pitch, we're now in a really dynamic open space. Indoor outdoor space. So I don't know. It's a fantasy.
Well, you said we're not solving it today, right?
We're not solving it today, and we can dream. You know, let us dream. The transportation department's letting us dream on Crowchild, so you know, we'll take that. Okay, so we have about 11 minutes left. Are there, Robert, any other critical elements that we need to be talking about on this particular subject?
Well, I think I had a couple of other questions, but they were answered as we were talking. So I'm fine with that. I think I'm okay. I mean, so much of the program is set, you know, there isn't a lot to comment on. I really like the idea that your main indoor components will be combined into one large complex that people can travel from one end to the other end. It makes programming so much easier. It makes tournaments and all kinds of competitions so much better. And that's a good thing. So that's a real bonus going forward down the road. So you've got your cluster of indoor facilities, you've got your cluster of outdoor, you've got the stadium-centered activities, and then you've got all kinds of people places outdoors to make it a warm and comfortable and inviting kind of place to come to. People are going to want to come here. And when people want to come to a site, then along with that comes the services to meet their needs, everything from the patios and restaurants and bars and maybe even some shopping that relates to the activities that are going on on the site. The busier you can make it year round, the more value you're getting out of it. And I know that's one of the objectives for this site. So it's not just about recreation, it's also about entertainment. And that's, so we need to really think about that a lot. And you know, Calgary's population won't always be as young as it is. It will gradually age a bit. And depending on what your employment opportunities are, that will have quite an impact on whether people stay in your community and age with it. And so that will change the recreation and leisure dynamic if your population ages a bit more than it is right now. So we just have to think about the future as well as what's going on right now.
Great, well said.
I was going to ask Robert, if I can, sorry, Jeff, is kind of more of an open-ended question for you, is there something we're missing from all your experience with other things? Is there something we're missing? Because that would be the Achilles, or that's where I don't want to be after we're done all this and someone says, have you thought of blah? And it's a great idea. So I'm hoping you could maybe have an idea. And if we're not, that's good, but.
Yeah. Well, the only couple comments I'll make is that because so many things are givens, there's not a lot of room to put anything else in here unless it's pretty small. So, or unless you took away some of the residential or some of the other uses that you're looking at, which I assume are there to generate revenue for the redevelopment of this property. Is that fair to say? I know that's maybe oversimplifying it.
It would be to generate, it's several things. It's to increase the population in proximity to transit. It is to activate the site with a 24-hour population. A revenue component could be usable, but it's also, I mean, to live here as a student or otherwise would be pretty unique. So it's one of many considerations.
So something else then does jump to mind. Once we know more about the number of people who could be housed on this property, then you have to start thinking about the needs, what I call the neighborhood park needs of your community. Very different from, this is a regional, even a provincial national kind of a site in many respects. But we can't forget the fact that if you draw that many people on site that are relatively cut off because of major roads, then you need your local recreation to be well developed there as well. Your location for playgrounds and your location for smaller scale recreation sports facilities, lots of walking opportunities. I assume that's possible with some of the green space that's in between the housing, but it's pretty small. So that's something to keep in mind if I was thinking about something that's missing. You're mixing here residential and local, what I call local recreation needs, with the citywide, regional, provincial, national stuff. And just don't forget about the needs of your residents who will be a major part of this center, this property going forward.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point, Robert. And I think that takes us into our next session on public realm and parks. But that's something that came out of the community too, like what we potentially use the space now as just lingering public realm space. So what is that going to be maintained on the site? So I think that is a really good point.
Yeah, the language we've been using as well is community-based recreation, like Robert talked about, but also around uninvolved siblings and family. So even if we didn't have any people residing on the site, we'd still want some of the pieces Robert's talking about for the uninvolved siblings and spouses and families that end up on these regional athletic park sites. Right? We don't want to have 4, 5, 6, 8 car trips if they can come for something with their spouse or their child, and the rest of the family can be occupied without having to leave the site.
Yeah. I will keep the question in my mind as we move forward on this. If I can think of anything else that might be considered here, you could think of all kinds of things, but does it fit the theme of what you're trying to do? Does it fit your objectives? You know, some of the things I've already talked about, like the skating, the public spaces, the trails, the ability to walk around, anything linear recreation is in high demand. Doesn't matter what the age group is. One of the fastest growing leisure activities in the country is linear recreation based activities, cycling, walking, jogging. In the wintertime, if you can create skating opportunities, those are all important. And they're both neighborhood, they're both family oriented, as well as providing a site that people will travel from far away to come to. If you had a skating path here somewhere, I don't know, would that be the only one you have in Calgary? Do you all have a city?
We have quite a few of them actually.
Quite a few, okay, then maybe it's not as important. If you have quite a few and they're good ones, then you're probably okay. I don't know all of your city well enough to know what your needs are beyond what we're talking about here.
I say quite a few, but we have some pretty large parks that have extensive systems and that are probably more well suited to here. But your point is well taken that just simply, and this was in our Wrigley Field example, they've got a piece of turf for the summer, and that's where people have, you know, do yoga and all kinds of other stuff. And then they're able to put in a rink in the winter, and there's people skating and you know, they festoon lights and everything else. I think that's something we could look in the plaza for sure. And yeah, we could explore that further.
Yeah, you think about, you know, Nathan Phillips Square in Toronto, you think about, there's a beautiful new plaza, I just can't remember the name of it, that's gone into Mississauga now, that is just breathtaking, and it's got a winter summer theme to it. My little city of Peterborough is just building an urban, what they call an urban park, a downtown park, and the objective of it is to have it work well in the summer as well as extremely well in the winter. So there will be a skating rink or path in it, a place for markets and festivals and whatnot in the summertime. So this combination of winter and summer to get 12 months use out of it is something that for a site that is as important as this one, that you want to keep in mind. I know it is an objective. So
okay. It's interesting you bring that up. McMahon Group was looking at putting an ice rink inside the stadium during COVID to animate, but the health regulations or the health rules in place at the time didn't allow it.
Right. Well, we'll be through COVID eventually.
Yeah.
It keeps hanging on. It's on my back shoulder right now, dragging me down. So I'm only happy I get vaccinated. So I'm 65% safe.
So I just want to put it out there. I appreciate your comments, James. I know you have some of your other crew on the call here, and if anybody needs to contact us afterwards, would prefer to give us comments in another format than a live online webinar, that we're totally open to that, and we will continue to talk. The only thing I didn't get to, and I didn't realize until the end, and it may be a minor point, is some of our precedents really showed how the front door to the stadium, what became a permeable space through to see actually the you know, so when you come into that square, you could actually see through to the field. You know, again, I don't know that we would have too many comments coming out of that, but you know, that idea I think is so that it doesn't look, I mean, if you're gonna put a skating, you know, if they were thinking about putting a skating rink in there, you know, if it was open, it seems like a very closed facility right now. You have to kind of walk around and you get little peeks in it. Opening it up is, I think, does it would only, in my mind, increase ticket sales, not decrease. So it's not like people are going to hang out there and watch the game. So, or if they do, you know, we'll lots of beer. So anyway, that was my last comment. Robert, did you have something? It looks like you wanted to add one with it.
Yeah, one last thing. I just can't help myself here, but as soon as I think about the plaza at the front door of your stadium, and I think about what goes on in Toronto, for example, and I don't want to be too Ontario-centered here, but when you think about the square that's outside of the main rink, Scotiabank Place, where the Raptors play and the Leafs play, that outdoor space becomes a very important gathering place for literally thousands of people who can come there in non-COVID times and watch on a giant screen what's going on inside. They can't get in because it's either full or they can't afford the ticket price, but for free they can come down and watch the activity and share in, particularly in playoff time, the excitement. And so there again is where this kind of a square associated with your stadium makes absolute sense. It would be maybe one of the most important features you've got in your outdoor space on the entire site.
So that would feed into the LA Live kind of scenario, and you can name any other one across US. I'd suggest if and we are going to present it, I'm assuming based on the drawings I'm seeing, consider how you might differentiate it from what's going to happen down at the event center on the Stampede grounds.
Yeah.
Because there is the high street that's getting built down there as part of the Stampede's plans. And so I'd hate to see this diminished in some way or negated in some way because people compare it as a duplication.
That's a good point.
Point taken. I've played a little bit of defense on that. I mean, we've got two world-class facilities that are potentially going to be based here, and not doing something is would be a mistake. We don't have as much land in anywhere near as much land to work with as they have down there, so it will be a different beast. And yeah. We're also looking at renovating a stadium, not building something new.
Yeah, totally appreciate it. I'm thinking more how you sell it.
But I totally agree. Then that is another kind of political play on how we put that out there. So I'm completely with you. We're at 202. Again, we're available. You know, this is going on for the next couple of week and a half. So we are available offline if you'd like to talk to us, send us emails, and so we'll continue to be in touch on this, and then we'll touch base again next week and let you know what our findings are as we work towards our Friday presentation next Friday.
Great. So
with that, we'll go ahead and close it off. Thank you, everyone, for your time today.
Great. Thank you.
Great presentation.